probably pretty much that's it for, you know, for the NFL. But how the Chiefs wouldn't be any different, how that wouldn't make offense to them. I don't know what, how do you, so yeah, I see we're streaming again. Let's see here, waiting for it to come back live. Hey, we're back live. Hello. What's happening with it?
Yeah. dress a hair, uh-huh. And the sun freezes over when the Mojave red turns into blue.
That's a long time.
Then my lungs get tired of breathing, oh. And my heart stops its beating.
I'll stop loving you.
I'll smack you in the mouth, I'm Neil Diamond!
Well, I think we're back live. Try to go Ustream. Ustream is acting up, does not want to... I restarted, and I'm getting a not responding error out of it, so I don't know what's going on with Ustream. But I think we're back online. I'm broadcasting. Who knows? Somehow I must not be able to do is keep the bandwidth going. I don't know why Ustream be having so much time or so much trouble. But... Speaking of schools, closing screens and opening screens as we're talking here. So if I sound preoccupied. Let's see here. So, we're back live. I'll keep an eye on the actual broadcast, see if we lose it here again. If we do, it might be an early night. I don't know what it is, but... Kids are getting banned, or told that they can't wear shirts to school. In Gresham, Oregon, Dexter McCarty Middle School, which is surprising because most of your schools are named after presidents, at least they are here. It says Alan Holmes understands that his freedom is intricately tied to those who fought and died defending the United States of America. His older brother joined the U.S. Marines when he was 19 and served in Iraq, but officials apparently don't share Holmes' understanding of patriotic spirit when recently forced the 8th grader to change his shirt that depicted the traditional soldier memorial on cope with how rough their life is. I talked to a dad today. His daughter, unfortunately, committed There we go. I have no idea what's going on. So I just rebooted my whole internet connection, so maybe that'll make a difference in it. It is going crazy. But getting back to what I was talking about is we're talking about young people committing suicide and service members coming back. They, you know, from over with having to sit there and deal with the situations that they've been through and then come back and now, you know, they've been any moment, you know, they could be killed and then they come back and they have to do is turn that off. So it's the stress is so much. And then you get these kids who go away from school into school had never been away from their family. You know, never been away from mom and dad, and then all of a sudden now they're living on their own, and some people can't handle it. But it's so much easier to go home. Don't take your own life. Don't do the unthinkable. You leave so many scars on the people that you leave behind. I would much rather see somebody come home than to sit there and have to deal with something like that. I feel so bad, you know, because I talked with him within 3-4 weeks before his daughter decided to do the unthinkable. You know, you think about what her roommate has to, you know, think about when she walks in, opens up a door. She's scarred for life. I felt really bad for this gentleman. He told me that his son, who they're like, you know, they're twins, that he didn't even know. He saw her that the day before and was going to see her that night. So, I mean, it's just one of those deals where you can't predict what's going to happen. I had a friend of mine when I was down in Texas. He was Christmas Eve sitting with his family. His wife, young daughter, 6 months old, unwrapping presents. His wife gets up in their apartment, walks into the bedroom, grabs her husband's pistol, and proceeds to blow her head off. Well, the police come. They take him down. They grill him for 6 or 8 hours, thinking that he did it because he's got blood all over him because he went in and tried to revive her. But when they found out he had no GSR, which is gunshot residue, on him, and his story finally checked out, where did they stop? But for 6 or 8 hours, they grilled him nonstop, trying to get him to admit that he killed his wife, which predominantly most times it would be. But I felt, you know, I knew him personally, and I mean, he was this totally different person after that. It was like somebody, you know, swapped out a different person. We talked quite a bit about the incident. I felt really bad about it. I mean, I don't know what you do. I mean, it's just those are the type of incidents that you just you don't wish on anybody. She was so depressed for her, the reason why she committed suicide was because of her father had died like 6 months earlier, and this was her first Christmas without her father. So she went and took her own life and gave up the, you know, the 6-month-old baby and her husband. I mean, it's just, I don't know where, what makes you go to that extreme. I mean, it's, you know, an area or whatever I don't have the expertise in. And I've never been, luckily, I've never been that depressed. It's kind of like this kid in Oregon. What gets him to the level where he thinks it's acceptable, which he had no intentions of coming out alive. You know, what gets them the mindset to go and shoot people? You can set all the laws you want. You can do, you know, everything and try to do is stop, you know, you're trying, they want to get rid of guns. They try to do is blame the gun owner and put them out to be crockpots or crackpots or whatever you want to. And they're crazy for wanting to have their gun to protect themselves. But these are the same actors. I don't know if you happen to see SNL skit over last Saturday, where they had the big skit about guns and making fun of gun owners to make them out like they're weird idiots. But how many actors do you see going and doing stupid stuff into drugs and you know, if somebody goes out and they're driving a car and they get arrested for drunk driving, they don't blame the car. They don't even blame the alcohol. I mean, you look at the USC coach, Sarkisian. He's got an alcohol problem. He finally, I guess, is admitting it. But you look at him. He has an alcohol problem. And what do? They relieve him from duty. They don't blame the alcohol. They don't blame the beer distributor. For if a guy goes out and gets drunk and he runs into another car, they blame the drunk driver, as they should. They always say intoxication is not a defense to prosecution. So, a drunk driver, he's out there, and causes injuries to others, he should be responsible for his own actions. If a guy chooses to grab a gun and shoot people, he should be responsible for his own actions. It's not the gun's fault. The gun has nothing to do with it. The gun doesn't accidentally go off. I mean, there are incidents where guns accidentally do go off because somebody accidentally pulled the trigger, but a gun doesn't just sit there and accidentally go off. There are a lot of people feel that that they're going to try to take guns away no matter what we do. And they don't want to admit it, because if they admit it, there will be a uproar against it. But one thing that I do notice and have noticed, the more they talk about banning the guns, the more gun sales happen. But you look at currently, right now, you know, you're talking about concealed carry holders. You don't hear about them. I talked about this last Friday. You don't hear about them going around and you know, showing their guns and doing everything and getting involved in shootings all the time. But here's a good instance. A concealed carry permit holder was praised for shooting an armed robbery suspect around 5 a.m. on October 10th, thereby stopping a robbery of a Waffle House in Charleston, South Carolina. Apparently, Waffle House had been one of them that had come out trying to say that they were, I don't know if this one was, but was a gun-free zone. Weapons free. But it said on September 27th, a Waffle House in Nicholsville, Kentucky refused to serve a uniformed National Guard soldier because he had his gun holstered in plain sight. A waitress told him he would have to leave his gun outside if he wanted service. In the face of public outcry over treatment of the soldier and gun policy that keeps law-abiding citizens defenseless in the face of danger, the Nicholsville Waffle House said, "For many years we've had a no-firearms policy in place in our restaurants. We continue to believe the best policy for the safety of our customers and associates. The customers in Charleston was armed, however, and intervened, which helped protect the Waffle House customers and employees." You know, if a teacher was carrying a gun, I just got a tweet. I don't want to mention her name because I shouldn't have to do that, but a friend of mine, his wife is an expert in depression. So much so, when mass shootings happen, she gets called if they suspect depression. Well, that's impressive. Maybe I'll have her on and talk to her sometime. Would she be willing to do that? I'm getting messages on the side there. Ask her. But, so if in a shooting like at the Waffle House, if teachers or other employees were armed in schools and in colleges, would it have saved lives? If somebody was armed in the Oregon school, would it have saved lives? They have a study that is out that if, let's see here, I was looking it up, but here's a law professor. He said, "Campus carry, the common sense solution to campus shootings." On October 9th, Charles Haywood, Purdue University, associate professor of business law, contended the common sense solution to campus shooting is campus carry, a mechanism that allows students and faculty the legal avenue of being armed on campus for self-defense. It said Haywood has been teaching at Purdue University for 11 years. He said the Oregon Community College attack, it dawned on him that students are sitting ducks and would be helpless to defend them. Bingo, right there, sitting ducks. If you, that's what the framers of the Constitution meant by allowing the right to bear arms. They didn't want us to be sitting ducks to where our government if it was run by the wrong people, or other governments or other people that could come in and we wouldn't be able to defend ourselves. That is the reason why we have the right to bear arms. When there's an epidemic, you know, they call mass shootings and the shootings with the pistols an epidemic. If somebody commits suicide, there's 40-some thousand suicides a year. If somebody is to commit suicide, if you take away the pistol, they're going to find another avenue to do it if they're that depressed. It doesn't have to be just a gun. The gun just happens to be the easy way out. They didn't take anybody else out. Either that, or they're going to do is they're going to go and they're going to start their car up in the garage and asphyxiate themselves. Or they're going to take pills. Or they're going to slit their wrists. Or they're going to hang themselves. They're going to find a way to do it. But stopping, taking away the gun is not going to stop it. Look in Jerusalem right now, and they're having massive amount of stabbings going on. And it's not just knives. They're stabbing people with screwdrivers, anything they can get a hold of. I you know, from when I grew up, and yes, social media gets it out instantly. But they are so, liberals are so bent on getting gun control that they're reporting fake stories. Apparently, Vice magazine calls a parking lot brawl another mass shooting after three were wounded and one was killed on October 9th at a North Arizona University, NAU. Vice magazine ran the headline, "Yet another mass shooting has left one dead and three injured at a Northern Arizona University." The problem is there wasn't a mass shooting. Rather, it was just a parking lot brawl between rival groups. At some point during the brawl, 18-year-old Stephen Jones allegedly shot and killed another person. The fight was contained in the parking lot, and the school was not even placed on lockdown. Yet Vice described it as just the latest in what seems to be never-ending series of mass shootings on American soil. Vice then turned to the shooting tracker, the website that counts any shooting where four or more are wounded in mass shooting, and suggested that shooting at NAU makes 299th mass shooting of 2015. Yet, it wasn't a mass shooting. Vice said the shooting comes on the same day that President Barack Obama is scheduled to visit with the families those killed on October 1st shooting. And when President Obama came, he was heckled because they didn't like that he was trying to push his agenda for gun control. Because in Oregon, up there, guns are a pretty good-sized part of their community up there. They hunt, use it for protection, everything. I posted on my Facebook, and I get constant barrage of Facebook stuff, but I posted a cartoon, and a picture. The picture is, "Gunman at large, protect yourself," and these people are all watching TV, and they run over to a sign that says "gun-free zone" out in the middle of the open, and they all hug it, like that's going to really protect yourself. But I saw a nice sign, and this is a college in Texas says, "Please be aware that the staff at Detroit Independent School District," so this is going to be a high school, "are armed and may use force whatever force is necessary to protect her students. And I had to like that. I think that was great. That's the way it should be. You should be have your kids defended. I want my kids knowing that when they go to school, that they're going to be protected. We had a story going around Facebook here, and I don't know if people got to see it that live here locally, but it was talking about a local, a guy was driving up to, and he named the street corner. I don't want to do his, actually mention the street corner on air, but apparently they mentioned the street corner, and they were talking about how they had pulled up and they saw a car next to them. And next to them, they saw the window crack down, and then they seen a gun come out of the window. Well, the gun come out of the window, they hit the gas, took off, and they went right directly to the PD station. Well, police department told them that there is new gangs that are in town, and they are, one of their initiations is to shoot a random person. Well, it's and they said, you know, be on your, you know, be safe and watch out. Well, I talked to to some people, and you see different conflicting stories. Well, they are definitely not going to show or talk about. They don't want to advertise it. They don't want to scare anybody. They're not going to tell you whether it's active or not. Because if they do tell you that, all it's going to do is create widespread panic. So what they do is they just don't publicize it. But they say, well, why wouldn't we tell, or why wouldn't they tell? And, well, the thing about it is, I know for a fact they don't. I know about an incident that occurred not that long ago where there was a shooting exchange and the cars were wrecked. So, yeah, I mean, it's just incidents where they're not going to bring them up. So, it's something that we need to do is always be on the aware, because if you don't, you know, you could run into an instance. Or be part of an incident that you don't want to. It's so dangerous now. I tell my kids, my son, he goes out with his buddies. I'm like, buddy, be very smart. Do not go to areas where you shouldn't be. You know, and he, oh yeah, I will. Well, everybody likes to think that they're never going to happen to them. But, you know, bad stuff does happen. You go around long enough, you're going to run into the bad stuff. Let's see here. And if they don't want us to have weapons, maybe you can answer a question. Why would the EPA be spending millions on military-style weapons? It said the EPA has spent millions of dollars over the last decade on military-style weapons to arm its 200 special agents to fight environmental crime. Among the weapons purchased are guns, body armor, camouflage equipment, unmanned aircraft, amphibious assault ships, radar and night vision gear, and other military-style weaponry and surveillance activities, according to the new report by the watchdog group Open the Books. protecting the environment just got real with millions of dollars spent on military weaponry. The EPA is now literally ensconced in an institutional force. I mean, what would they have? What would they need military-style weapons to enforce environmental protection? What would they have to do? What? Who are they going to take down that you're going to need military weapons and flak vests and everything? EPA estimates that each special agent costs the taxpayers $216,000 a year in salary, travel equipment, training, and other expenses, according to the report. Where can I get a job? $216,000 a year. The agency spends nearly $75 million a year on criminal enforcement, including money for small militia of 200 special agents charged with fighting environmental crime. It said Congress granted police powers to the EPA in 1988 during the Reagan administration. The EPA's military weapons spending is just one example of the agency's questionable purchases, highlighting the 40-page report. Open the Books, a nonpartisan and nonprofit group based in Illinois, scanned tens of thousands of the agency's spending contracts totaling more than $93 billion from 2000 to 2014. Among the findings were hundreds of millions of dollars on high-end office furnishings, sports equipment, and environmental justice. Grants to raise awareness of global warming. The report also reveals that 7 of the 10 EPA employees make more than $100,000 a year, and more than 12,000 of its 16,000 employees were given bonuses last year despite budget cuts. The EPA also employs more than 1,000 attorneys, making it one of the largest law firms in the country. The agency also spent over $50 million since 2000 to international organizations, including groups in Mexico and China. That's our EPA. I don't know. It makes sense to you? Doesn't quite make sense to me. And if they do, when can I get hired? Did you feel that whoosh? That whoosh go by? Apparently NASA says a giant asteroid missed the Earth in a near miss at a distance of 15 million miles. Space agency takes unusual steps of issuing the all clear amid fears that the asteroid 8666 2000 FL10 was headed right for us. Said NASA says this will not happen, at least not this weekend. At 1.5 miles wide, a collision with the asteroid 8666 2000 FL10 would be catastrophic. But on Friday, NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab, near Earth Object Office, which tracks asteroids, said it would not come closer than 15 million miles, about the distance between Earth and Mars. So, keep an eye out for that. Who knows? Maybe you'll see it go whizzing by. Hey, what's that planet? Well, we're going to take a quick break. Once again, this is Ben Hazer, host of Straight Talk. And yes, this show has been a bundle of crap. It has been a mess all night, kicking me on and off. So, we'll be back here shortly.
Mm-hmm. Is your wife wicked hot? Or is she just cold? Do you just want to take a hot shower? Call Savino Mechanical for all your heating, hot water, and cooling needs. Savino Mechanical has been servicing Greater Boston and Southern New Hampshire for over a quarter century. Quality 24-hour service, reasonable rates, satisfaction guaranteed, licensed and insured. And remember, at Savino Mechanical, we are not comfortable until you are. Call Savino Mechanical today at 1-855-624-4280. That's 1-855-624-4280. Savino Mechanical.
Attention, World of Tank gamers. Armed and its affiliated divisions are recruiting entire clans and tankers. Armed, the largest and most progressive gaming community on the World of Tanks gaming platform. Now on three servers. To join, visit www.armedtank.net or hashtag need a toaster. Toast that, bitches.
Train in the art of traditional Taekwondo. Chung Kim's Black Belt Academy was opened in the Quad Cities in 1972. Teaching and training established by Knight Dan, Grandmaster Chung Kim. Classes range from Little Tiger's class, beginners, intermediate, and advanced level classes. Hop Kie classes also available. Sign your children up and your parents train free with no contracts. For more information, call 563-359-7000 and like us on Facebook at Chung Kim's Black Belt Academy or visit us on the web at www.chungkim.com. Taekwondo is your life's path.
Need a dose of Raw Reality Radio? Listen in to Night Talk with Joe Rocks every Thursday, 10 p.m. Eastern, exclusively on Armed Radio Global, with audio replays on Spreaker and live feed video on Ustream.tv. Or call in live to Night Talk with Joe Rocks at 1-866-225-5401, Thursdays, 10 p.m. Eastern.
Join me every Wednesday night for On the Air, 10 p.m. Central Standard Time, right here on Armed Radio.
Hey, everybody, this is Jimmy.
And this is Paul.
We are hosting a new show called Pod Talk, Politically Offensive Talk.
It's going to be about politics, religion, the presidential race, current events.
We're going to have some guests that come on, hopefully Donald Trump himself. Wishful thinking.
No, we're going to have Hillary on.
Yeah, but that would be nice. I'd love to get a hold of Hillary.
I totally hate fucking that.
So come and join us on Thursday nights at 11 p.m. Eastern, right after Night Talk with Joe Rocks.
Let's see here. Oh, we're talking about technology, with the EPA getting technology, but apparently they have a new, they call it, let's see here. Where is it? I'm looking, oh, new Viper drone, or Vampire drone, I'm sorry. The Vampire drone that disappears in sunlight. Good name for it. Pentagon calls for the design that drops payload at night before vanishing without a trace. Icarus program is named after boy in Greek myth who flew close to the sun. Aims to develop drones capable of carrying a small payload that vanish within 4 hours of payload delivery or within 30 minutes of twilight. There's a possibility that the final design may disappear in a puff of smoke. Remains that the craft must be no larger than the grain of sand. Yeah, right. So, this was Sarah Griffiths from Mail Online created this report. It's a drone can drop supplies to hidden special forces or essential medical kit in war zones. But there's a risk that their presence may give off the recipient's location or that the technology ends up in enemy hands. To solve this problem, the Pentagon is calling for designs for vampire drones that disappear in daylight. The Defense Advanced Research Project Agency, DARPA, is funding the new project to develop aircraft that can be fully vanish within 4 hours of payload delivery or within 30 minutes of morning civil twilight, assuming a night drop, which is whatever is earlier. So, pretty interesting. I don't know all the technology to be involved in, but it kind of makes me think of the when you see that you look at them from below and you'll see the blue sky or whatever. So, it amazes me some of the things that they're coming out with. It's like I think it's the F-35. The way the helmet is designed, the pilot can look through the floor of the aircraft. I'm like, that's crazy. So, also we're talking about, let's see. Oh, we'll get into that later, Halloween displays starting to pop up all over the place. Some very, very intense displays. There was my niece, her husband, and her put up a huge display in their yard. They have an electric chair, and they have the... he's a big Dolphins fan, so he puts a Green Bay Packer skeleton in the electric chair. But they actually live on Elm Street, which is kind of cool. But apparently, this one in New Jersey has been dubbed the most tasteless Halloween display ever. It's an ISIS-themed diorama featuring a hanging soldier, a Jordanian pilot who is burned alive, and a terrorist in an Obama mask sparked outrage in New Jersey. The front yard in Butler, New Jersey, is offending the local community. The homeowner said he chose to make a statement and politicize. He said that the real horror is better than fake and a real threat. Neighbors have said it's tasteless and un-American. The Obama mask has since been removed from the mannequin. A house in Parma, Ohio, has also offended with its gruesome display. But if you check them out, go to... I think this one was on... who was Drudge or one of them. I saw it pop up. But it had pictures of the whole yard and close-ups of all the current displays. So... they were, and then they even have one of the one in Ohio. Some pretty nasty ones. I mean, they're pretty really detailed. Fake blood, needles sticking out, got them hanging on a cross upside down, with needles in the neck and needles in the hands. Yeah, it's, and then one, it's got a guy looks like he's skewered upside down with his mouth open. Right to the back, that's in his neck. And it's got a big sword or knife sticking in his neck. It's pretty elaborate. But the one that I think thought was pretty funny was a Detroit woman had been decorating her home the same way for 25 years, had created a bit of controversy of her own because what's in her front yard. She put a stuffed body in her front yard that attracts attention each year because it looks so lifelike. Apparently, according to the Detroit News, the body's drawn attention to passerbys, emergency workers, and even police. I guess it said, Haddon said that corner is always full of cars, people running up to it to try to do CPR. Once they found out it's a dummy, it's so hilarious. She started putting the body face down in honor of her husband's birthday on Halloween and has drawn so much attention that Haddon had started taking the corpse in after sundown. Haddon said, if you don't bring him in at night, he won't be there in the morning. I learned my lesson. I had to bring him in at night. But on Halloween, he stays out all night. I'll just keep my doors open until we go to bed. So another Halloween-related prank went awry when a Colorado girl who showed up wearing a trench coat and a gas mask prompted the institution to shut down. The girl caused public county high school to shut down for 2 hours, and she was suspended. She was not armed, and authorities told her there was nothing more than a Halloween prank. But you look at this body, if you saw it laying in the yard, it's got shoes, everything in black, it would kind of draw your attention. So, I don't know if I would want to do that and shock everybody, but I don't know, it's kind of fun just to see the reaction. Apparently, this has been reported in the UK. It says, UK police says, witchcraft and exorcisms on the rise. Britain's Metropolitan Police have reported an increase in the number of child abuse cases involving allegations of witchcraft and exorcism. Police said Sunday a specialist unit received 46 such cases in 2014, more than twice as many as the year before. The Project Violet unit says 60 incidents have been reported so far this year, continuing the trend upward. Detective Sergeant Terry Sharp said the number of incidents remained small in number, but there had been a significant increase. He said one case, a 9-year-old boy called a devil child and thrown out of his home by his parents. Another case involved a mother who believed her son was a witch and tried to bite him and smother him. That's where I think the mental health people need to get in there, and it might be for the parents. It's crazy to think stuff like that happens. There was an article that came out, and I thought it was kind of funny. They were poking and it was the leading story on Drudge, and which really caught me. How could this be the leading story on Drudge today? Highlighted. It says Hillary Clinton, and it's this is quotes, so it's like her. It says, "I'm really not even a human being." It said Hillary Clinton declared in a new interview that she is a robot, implying that humanity should despair and bend to her superior AI will by voting for her in the 2016 election. The shocking admission came during an interview with BuzzFeed podcast Another Round, in which an astute interviewer noted that the Democratic presidential candidate did not sweat during the interview. Other reporters said Clinton and associates have remarked upon Clinton's unremarkable ability to not sweat, even when working the rope line on a hot Iowa day. "I don't mean sweat because you're nervous," said host Tracy Clayton. "I just mean physically I'm generally curious what your deodorant is." After some banter over the thermostat and the traditional one weird fact about Clinton, "The weirdest thing about me is I don't sweat," BuzzFeed foolishly suggested that Clinton was a robot. And BuzzFeed, "You fools, you don't go around provoking dangerous artificial intelligence. Hillary Clinton, you guys are the first to realize that I'm really not even a human being. I was constructed in a garage in Palo Alto a very long time ago. People think that you know Bill Gates and Steve Jobs. They created it." Oh, no, I mean, "A man whose name shall remain nameless created me in the garage." Another round. "Are there more of you?" Hillary Clinton. "I thought he threw away the plans. At least that's what he told me when he programmed me. And there'll be no more. I've seen more people that kind that don't sweat and other things that make me think that they are part of a new race that's being created, the robotic race." And it said, another round. So there's a cyborg army, is what you're saying, Killer Clinton. But you have to cut this. You can't tell anybody. I don't want anybody to know this. This has been a secret until we are here. This has been a secret until here. We are in Davenport, Iowa. It's where I'm at right now. My electronic guts to you. And it says another round without and without bourbon. Hillary Clinton, without any bourbon, yeah, that's why I have to wait until the end of the day. So upon hearing this news, members of the Benghazi Special Committee likely wondered whether Hillary had a second personal email hidden email server in her spleen, as well as whether she lied about anything else. So elsewhere, in another round interview, Clinton was asked whether she and Bill Clinton had ever felt like they effed this up when it came to tough on crime legislation. Hillary Clinton also said she felt people were really nice to me while she was Secretary of State and addressed sexism on Capitol Hill. So, but I didn't know she was telling everybody she was a robot here in Davenport, Iowa. So, what we're able to do is stay connected for the last hour, which is great. And what we're going to do is call it a night rather than starting into any other stories and topics. But once again, go Cubs, go. Make sure you tune in tomorrow. You'll have Talk Time with Val. And Suspense is going to immediately follow her. So make sure you listen in for Suspense. And Wednesday night on the air with Mike Allen. Thursday night, Night Talk with Joe Rocks, and I'll be back on Friday. And right before me on Mondays, you got Spot On with Leno. So make sure you do is tune in for all the great shows and have a great night, a great week, and most of all, be safe.